Good morning. Today we are looking at fractures. Mrs. Daka. Look at the specific objectives. We are going to define a fracture. We'll talk about the causes, the classification of fractures, and the signs and symptoms. And then we'll look at the healing process of a fracture. We'll also look at the methods used in the management of fractures, and we'll discuss complications, and lastly we'll look at the factors that delay fracture healing. Let's define what is a fracture. A fracture is a break in the continuity of a bone. A bone separates into two or more pieces. Or sometimes it may not separate completely, but it will crack, it will bend and then crack. That is still called a fracture. Sometimes the fracture will not only involve the bone, it may involve the blood vessels around it, the nerves, and the muscles around that bone. That is still called a fracture with a lot of complications. Let's move on as we discuss fractures. What are the causes? A fracture can occur because of gunshot, because of blows, road traffic accidents, or falls, infections like osteomyelitis. Osteomyelitis simply means inflammation of the bone. Then we also have extreme muscle contraction and sudden twisting motions. As you move, you twist your body or you twist your joint in such a way that the bone is broken. Let's move on. What are the classifications? I have put the fracture classifications differently, with their different appearances, different locations, or given different names because of what is going on in that fracture. But as we discuss, you discover that some of the fractures, the description is similar to the other one, depending on which area the fracture has occurred. So let's move on. Let's start with an open fracture. If this is a break in the bone where the bone is protruding outside, it is being seen outside. There is communication between the environment and the broken bone. This is what we call an open fracture. A closed fracture is where the skin is intact, but the bone inside is still broken. It is not protruding. So this is also called the closed fracture. Let's look at the pictures. These are examples of a closed and open bone or a fracture. You see the bone on an open fracture, the bone is protruding outside the skin, whilst in a closed fracture, the bone is still inside and the skin outside is intact. Let's move on. This is another example of an open fracture. You see that actually the bone is almost completely outside. We move on. The other type of classification of fractures is according to the extent of the damage that has been done, whether it is complete or incomplete or partial fracture. Meaning a complete fracture will mean that the whole bone is completely broken into two or more fragments. The incomplete or partial fracture is where only part of the bone, only one side of the bone is broken, while the other side of the bone is intact. This is a common thing in what we call a green stick fracture. We will see more and more as we differentiate these types of fractures. We move on. These are examples of a complete and incomplete fracture. So you see that in the first picture, there's an incomplete fracture, while in the second picture, we see a complete fracture where the bone is completely broken. Let's move on. A green stick fracture is similar to an incomplete fracture. The only thing is a green fracture only happens in children, where the bones for children is still more of cartilage, and because of that cartilage tissue that they are having, they only bend and can crack on one side or one area. But in a green stick fracture, there is a bend and there may also be a fracture. There is no complete fracture in a green stick fracture. Are we together? Can we move on to talk about the impacted or telescoped fracture? This is a fracture where the bone is broken, but one part of the bone goes inside the other part of the broken bone. That is what we call impacted fracture. Let's move on, and we'll look at the pictures as we go down. This is a green stick fracture. You can see in the first picture, the bone is bending. It has a crack, but it is bending. Are we together? Can we move on? This picture is showing us an impacted fracture where the bone is broken and one part of the bone goes inside the other broken part of the bone. This is what we call impacted fracture. We move on. The other type of fracture that we have under the extent of the damage is still commuted fracture and complicated fracture. Commuted fracture is more, it is having more fragments. It has been broken more than twice. It has more pieces. That is what we call commuted. Whereas complicated fracture is where the other parts of the fractured area are also injured. For example, the blood vessels, the tissues, the nerves are all involved. Then you know this is a complicated fracture. Sometimes it may also involve the joint. We move on. So these are the example that you see on a complicated fracture. On the last part of the picture, you will see that actually the bone is not only broken, but it has injured the blood vessels, it has also injured the nerves. Can we move on? The complicated fracture it can also be called compound fracture, where other vessels are also involved, other tissues of the body are also involved. This is, can also be called a compound fracture. We move on. This is another example of a compound fracture. Let's go on. The other type of classification of fractures is where we are following the long axis of the bone. It's either the fracture is longitudinal or oblique or spiral or transverse, depending on which part of which style has it followed. Has it followed the bone in the longitudinal area, or in the oblique area, or in the spiral area, or in a transverse manner? So when you look at the this type of fractures, they are only depicting how the broken, how the bone has been broken. So the when we are saying longitudinal, we are saying the fracture line is parallel to the long axis. It is following the long axis. Okay. Then when we are saying oblique, it means the fracture has occurred in that bone in an oblique direction at 45 degrees angle. When we say it is a spiral fracture, it means the fracture has encircled the bone. And when we say the transverse fracture, we are saying the fracture is following the perpendicular line to the long axis of the bone. Let's look at the different pictures to see how we can describe them, or how you can understand them better. So these are the fractures that are following the long axis, the positions of the bones. So you can see there's transverse, there's oblique, there's spiral, comminuted, alversion type of fracture, impacted. It can have a fissure, and it can be a green stick. So in all these type of fractures, you see that actually, as I explain more and more, you understand them more and more as you look at the pictures and as you look at the notes. Let's move on. These are also pictures of similar fractures, but I included them because they have a few notes that you can read and begin to understand how best you can describe the fracture. There's the spiral, the oblique, the transverse, the green stick, the fissured, and the comminuted fracture. So read through these notes and look more at these pictures, and it will give you an insight on how to describe a fracture. Let's move on. Fractures can also be classified according to the joint they are, that is involved, or how near the fracture is to the joint. So in this case, we are describing the fracture that is near to the articular part of the joint, or they are in the extracapsular area, or they are inside the capsule of the joint. Then it is described according to the place where the fracture has occurred. Let's move on. The fractures can also be classified according to the physician who described them first. We have these three types of fractures that were named after the physicians who described these fractures first. So we have Colles fracture, Potter's fracture, and Smith's fracture. I'll explain them more and more as we go down. Let's move on. Let's look at Colles fracture. Colles fracture is named after the physician, or the doctor, Abraham Colles, in 1814. Colles fracture is the fracture that occurs at the distal end of the radius, where the distal articular surface is broken, or it breaks off because of the type of fall. And as we go down, I'll explain more and more how this colis fracture looks like. Let's move on. This is how the colis fracture is. It is just at the end of the radial bone, just on the wrist. And we'll be able to describe it more and more as we go down. Let's move on. So these are pictures of colis fracture. You see the top picture where you only see the swelling on the wrist joint. You not see what is going on, but as you look at the x-ray, you see that there is a broken bone just at the end of the radial bone. Let's move on. So this is how the fracture looks like on an x-ray. If you check the x-rays, the patient's x-ray, you see that there is a crack just before the wrist joint, and the fracture will be showing on the x-ray, like you see in picture A and in picture B. Let's move on. The colis fracture will actually look like a fork. The corner or the bend that the bending that the fork makes is what the fracture will appear like on the hand of this patient. And when it is not well treated, there will be a complication, and that complication, the patient's hand will have a fork-like structure, which we call the fork deformity. Let's move on. Let's look at the Smith's fracture. It is a fracture that is still affecting the wrist joint, more or less at the same place with colis. The difference is that for colis fracture, the patient had a fall using their palm. They touched the palm on the ground or as they were falling. So the palm made the impact of the weight made the bone to break. Whilst in Smith's fracture, the palm was upside down. They used the outer part of the palm to touch the ground as they were falling, and then the fracture occurred on the opposite direction of the colis fracture. So this is more or less called a reversed colis fracture. Let's look at the picture so that you see the difference that is between colis fracture and this Smith's fracture. So the top picture is showing the colis fracture, where the person is falling with their palms spread out, making the colis fracture, the outward break that happens on the radius bone. While the Smith's fracture, the palm is directed on the opposite side, and as the patient falls, the break happens on the opposite side of the radius bone, and it is called reversed colis fracture. Let's move on. The other type of fracture that we have is what we call Potti's fracture. Potti's fracture is where the ankle is broken at the fibula, at the distal end of the fibula and the tibia bones. So you see that actually the fracture that is taking place in Potti's fracture is the tibia and the fibula at the end as they join to the ankle joint. Let's move on. So this is a picture of Porti's fracture, where you see the fracture happening at the distal end of the tibia and the fibula. Let's move on. The other types of fractures that we have is what we call a depressed fracture, where the broken bone is driven inwards. This is a common for skull and facial bones. When you have a fracture on the skull, you will discover that that bone will be pressed inside, and that is what we call depressed fracture. Alveolar fracture is where the ligaments are pulled, or the fragments of the bone are pulled together with the ligaments and the tendons. It mainly happens just near a joint. Then the other type of fracture that we are talking about is a pathological fracture, where we have the bone going into having a fracture because it is diseased. It has a disease and it is so soft, and then you see that the fracture is actually happening because the bone is very weak. We move on. So these are examples of different fractures. Like we have said, we've seen all these others, but my main focus here is the pathological fracture, where the fracture, the bone is diseased and it develops a fracture. We move on. Let's look at the signs and symptoms of fractures. And I have used the word slip duct B as a way of remembering the signs and symptoms. So let's use these words, or this word, so that we can describe how the signs and symptoms of fractures occur. So the first one is swelling. Then later on, there will be loss of function. Then there will be irregularities on the bone surface where the fracture has happened. Then there will be pain. There will be deformity. The other ones is there will be the unnatural movement. If you try to move that part of the bone, the natural way of moving that bone will not occur. Then the other symptom is the crepitus. We have already talked about a crepitus, and this is a cracking sound that we talked about. So you would see that the unnatural movement, the crepitus, are part of the broken bone. Let's move on. The last two signs and symptoms for a fracture is tenderness and bruising. You discover that the patient in the area where the fracture has occurred will have bruising and will end up with what we call ecchymosis. There will be the blood vessels, when they are injured, they will begin to release this blood around the area where the injury has occurred, and this blood will escape or will be found under the skin. And as the blood appears under the skin, this is what we call ecchymosis. So let's look at the picture of a patient who is having ecchymosis. This is a patient who had a fracture on this part of the hand, and there is ecchymosis that has occurred. Let's move on. How do we manage fractures? These are the methods that we started with. We talked about reduction of the fracture, immobilization of the fracture, and then we can say restoration of its function. Then the first one, basically, when we are talking about reduction, when you read your notes on a reduction, where there's open reduction and closed reduction, then we will immobilize this fracture, and then you will either use a POP, we use fixations that can be internal or external fixation, or we can use a traction. And as we come out of this immobilization, you discover that this patient has now gotten into the bone, has healed, and will begin to do exercises so that the bone can restore its normal function as before the injury. Let's move on. Let's look at the complications of fractures. Fractures, when they are not well reduced, when there is no internal, when there is no closed or open reduction, you discover that there is no union that may occur. So they may be delayed union. There will be delayed uniting of this bone. It may fail to, it may delay to unite. Then there was what we call non-union, where the bone completely fails to unite. Let's move on. The other complication is malunion, where the bone, because it was not well aligned, it has united, but with difficulties. The other part of the bone is not united, while the other part of the bone is united. The other complication that we have is nerve damage, and then infection is one of the complications of fractures. Let's move on. That's all for today. We will continue to look at the other, the healing, how the bone heals as we come to the next lesson. Thank you very much. God bless you. Bye.